"Teacher, what is the greatest commandment in the law?" He replied, "You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You must love your neighbor as you love yourself. All the law and the prophets depend on these two commands."
Okay, that's a text that many people are very familiar with, right? And it's one that you've heard me preach on before. We're going to look at it today in the context of being passionate, purposeful, progressive people. And today we're talking about being purposeful. Good or good?
Good.
All right. So we want to be purposeful about that commandment. Let me share this quote with you. "Don't allow yourself to think your life is insignificant. You are God's very handiwork, chosen and commissioned for God's purposes." We just talked about new members being called by God and called to serve God. We opened up service saying, "You are beloved children of God." Amen? So you are created by God for God's purposes. Amen? See, the question is not, what is my purpose in life? That's the wrong question. We are to be about God's purpose. We get twisted in the words and we want to know what it is God wants me to do. God's already told us a lot of that. All the specifics? No. The big picture? Yes. The starting plan? Yes. Because we need to ask, what is God's purpose in the world and what does God want us to do? Not just what's mine. I don't know if that's making sense to you or not, but hopefully it will. Let's listen to Proverbs 3. See if it gives any light to this question.
"My child, don't forget my instruction. Let your heart guard my commands, because they will help you live a long time and provide you with the well-being. Don't let loyalty and faithfulness leave you. Bind them on your neck. Write them on your tablet of your heart. Then you find favor and approval in the lives in the eyes of God and humanity. Trust in the Almighty with all your heart. Don't rely on your own intelligence. Know God in all your paths, and God will keep your ways straight."
See, when we start talking about what's my purpose, what we're really saying is, what am I supposed to do? Is that right? But let's talk about being. Keep that text back up, would you, for a moment? Here's some instructions of what are we supposed to do. Not to forget God's word, the instructions, to guard in your heart the commands. Why? Because they're going to help you on this path that you're trying to figure out. Good? Bind them on your neck and write them on the tablet of your heart. In other words, take the word of God. Don't just read it here where it's on the page, but let the word of God come into you. Are you with me on that? So that's what we need to do. If I'm wanting to be about God's purposes and find my path, I need to be doing this. I'm going to find favor in God's eyes and with humanity. Well, wouldn't you like to do that? Do you want to be loved by God and loved by others? Okay, here's how. Good. If I want to be in right relationship with God and with others, here's how. Trust God's word and apply it in my life. And then trust God, how? With all your heart. And don't rely on your own intelligence. Some of us do, or some of us try to figure it all out ourselves. Yeah? How's that been working for you? Not so well. And then that last sentence, know God in all your paths and God will keep your ways straight. Well, in Pride Month, you may say, wait a second. Yes, you're allowed to laugh. You may know that verse, some of you, from the old King James Version, in all thy ways acknowledge him and he shall direct thy paths. So God directing our paths. Do you want God to direct your path or do you want to do it? Some of us have different perspectives on what that might look like. There's a couple of different images. So some of us have this idea in mind. Some of us think that our plan, our idea, is straight from here to my goal. Yes? Some of us have a career goal in mind. Some of us have a financial goal in mind for retirement. And some of us have, I want my reservation in heaven. as our goal. But whatever the goal is, we sort of think it's a straight line from A to B. Some of us have the mindset that God is doing all kinds of crazy things to us. and it looks like that. But actually, if you, I'm going to come back to this one in a moment. So if you don't mind, let me go ahead to the next one. Because the truth is, some of us aren't sure, and we keep changing our mind about what our path is and what our goal is. I was headed this way, and then I changed my mind, and I changed my major how many times while I was in college? Some of you can relate to that. And so the path we have has changed by who we've met, yeah, by the stock market, by conflict, either in a family or a workplace or war. Right? And our path has been really more like that. And God's plan is direct. The scriptures say that God will direct thy path. And some people understand that as God will make your path straight. And some of you would like it to be an easy road. But if we'd go back to the first slide, I think that it's actually a combination of some of this, that God's plan is to get us from here to there. But there's a lot of things that come against us in life. But if you take a close look, I think it's God that provides that ladder, and God that provides the boat, and God provides the means for us to get out of some of the holes that we're in. Does that make sense to you? So that life happens, stuff happens in life, but God will direct our path so that we don't get stuck in that place and completely lose the path. So if God's purpose for us is over here, God's going to help us get over there, because God has a purpose for us to be here. Think about Jonah for a minute. God needed Jonah to announce to Nineveh, right? Do you think God had a desire for Jonah to spend some time inside the belly of a whale? I do not think so. But when Jonah tried to run away and took a ship going the other direction, and then there was a storm and Jonah got thrown off the ship and into the ocean, and then swallowed by the whale, who swims where? Directly to Nineveh and spits him up. In Nineveh. God got them there. You see what I'm saying? God will direct our paths and provide for us, even though the plan may seem really crazy. Here's the deal. We can go forward on slides. Those who want to know God's purpose for them are often really asking, I want you, God, to tell me exactly, specifically, concretely, what your purpose is for me. And the truth is, without clarity on that purpose, many people do nothing. We're waiting around for all the details and not doing anything in the meantime. The truth is that God's purpose in us is unfolding and gradually unfolding, and we may not be able to see it all at once. So I have to do what that text said in Proverbs, trust in God, who will direct my path. Is there an amen in the church? Yeah. On Sunday mornings and in the Denton Genesis group, we've been studying the life of Joseph. There's at least a 20-year gap in Joseph's life from the time that he had this dream, this vision of sheaves of wheat bowing down before him, till it evolved that he went through being sold into slavery, serving in a household, thrown into prison, being brought to Pharaoh's house, elevated in Egypt to providing for Egypt. It was almost 20 years before his brothers came seeking food during a time of famine, and they bowed down before him for him to realize God's purposes for him. 20 years. Did he know it all when he had the vision? He just knew God had something in store for him. It took a long time for it to unfold. How about you? And Joseph was in the right place at the right time, and he knew it was the hand of God that was providing for his own family through him. There's another way of looking at this, about this unfolding, and let's hear about it from Romans 8.
All around us, we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pains. But it's not only around us, it's within us. The Spirit of God is arousing us within. We also are feeling the birth pains. That's why waiting does not diminish us any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are enlarged in the waiting. We, of course, do not see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the larger we become, and the more joyful our expectancy. Meanwhile, The moment we get tired in waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside, helping us along. If we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. Spirit does our praying in and for us, making prayer out of our wordless sighs, our aching groans. The divine knows us far better than we know ourselves, knows our pregnant condition, and keeps us present before God. That is why we can be so sure that in every detail in our lives of loving God is worked into something good.
In our congregation, we've been blessed with a number of babies that have been born in our midst. And Mary's pregnant. And this baby's expected in July. Soon, very soon, right? And end of this month, yeah. And this entire time of being pregnant, this baby's been developing in her. And because of modern technology, you can now see an image of that child, but not a clear image, just sort of see in part. Do you have any idea about the personality of your son? You think active, because active here. When one is pregnant with a child, there's this growth and development that's going on that you know, that you're aware of, and yet you do not know all the details. Amen? Amen. You do not know all the details of everything that's going on with that development of that child. You do not know who that child will grow up to be. You do not know the personality of that kid. You don't know their likes and dislikes of all kinds of things, right? And yet, there's already a love. There's already a trust. There's already a connection of what will happen. Our purpose with God is very much like that. We are giving birth to God's purposes in us. And we don't know all the details. And that's what that text was trying to talk about, that there's an arousing within us. And some of you feel that drawing to serve God. You're saying, I just wish I knew what it was God wanted me to do. And we come back to that do again, rather than be with it. I just wish I knew it all. I just wish I knew it all. We could say it differently, couldn't we? And it has a different meaning. But it's being joyful in the pregnancy. And the text is very clear. When you get tired of waiting, Mary, are you ready for this child to be born? Yep. When you get tired in the waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside to help us on the journey. Not unlike God will direct your paths. The Spirit is there. And if we don't know how or what to pray, some of you have been there. I don't know what God's asking of me, and I don't even know how to pray about it. It says that the Spirit will do our praying for us, in us, and for us. So I have to stay connected to Spirit if I want that to be happening. Yes? Just stay connected and open. The divine knows us far better than we know ourselves. Do you believe that? Do you believe that God knows you better than you know yourself? Then I want us to start behaving like that. Because sometimes we think we know better. We act like we know better. We want to trust God, but we keep making the decisions ourselves. True or true? So I trust God, and I trust that God will work out every detail of our life. What is it? For everything works together for good for those who love God and are called according to God's purposes. Called according to God's purposes. Is there an amen for that? So I gave you a handout today. So I want to share some of these quotes here with you. The purpose of your time here on earth is not primarily about acquiring possessions, attaining status, achieving success, or experiencing happiness. Those are secondary issues. Life is all about love, with God and with other people. You may succeed in many areas, but if you fail to learn how to love God and love others, you've missed the reason why God created you. Look at that next one. Aim at heaven and you will get earth thrown in. Aim at earth and you get neither. You have a divine purpose that no one else can fulfill. You have to get out of the bleachers and into the game if you want to affect the outcome of your life. When things don't go according to your plan, it doesn't mean that things are not going according to God's plan. Having a rough day? Put a hand over your heart. Feel that? That's called purpose. You're alive for a reason. Don't give up. Success is not measured by what you do compared to others. It's measured by what you do with the ability God has given you. So what I'd like you to do now is to gather in twos or threes and talk about which one of those six quotes speaks to you the most and why. So we're talking about purpose and being purposeful. Which of those six quotes speaks to you the most and why? Let's take a couple of minutes to share together. Thank you. Thank you for sharing with each other. I hope that you'll take this home and maybe this week use a different saying each day to help you reflect on being a purposeful person, a purposeful person who wants to live within God's plan, even when you don't know the details of what that means. Even when you don't know the details, I'm still committed to living within God's plan for me. Make sense? So, I don't like all that vagueness, but let's hear what it says in Jeremiah.
I know that the plans I have in mind for you, declares the Lord, they are plans for peace, not disaster, to give you a future filled with hope. When you call me and come and pray to me, I will listen to you. When you search for me, yes, search for me with all your heart, you will find me. I will be present for you, declares the Almighty, and I will end your captivity.
This is all about trust and promise connection. I know the plans, God says, so do you need to know the details? I think this is an ongoing spiritual question for us. I want to know, and then I can follow the plan. Especially if you're a planner. How many here are people that plan out like a vacation in detail? Okay. And how many of you are spontaneous? And let's just go with the flow. I'm just going to start to drive. I think the spiritual walk of dealing with God's plan is equally challenging for the spontaneous people and for the people that need detailed plans. Because for the spontaneous people, God's continually saying, come on, back over here. No, over here, something else. And you're going, oh, squirrel. And God, come back here. And for the planners, they're like this. And they're like, that's the destination, but we're going this way. God may be taking us on a different route. But the plans that God has in mind for us are good. Plans for peace, not disaster. Future filled with hope. Isn't that what we all want? A future filled with hope and possibility. Then let's trust God's plan. Trust that God is a better project planner than we are. Yeah? And then it's clear again. When you call me, when you come and pray to me, I will answer. When you seek me, how? With all your heart. Doesn't that connect back to Matthew? Love the Lord your God, how? With all your heart. See, some of us seek God like we're doing a Google search. Serious. We just ask a question. We don't get an immediate answer. I'm done. I'm on to the next one. Next question. I'm doing the next search. Do you understand what I'm saying? But be present with the divine. And some of us also are so tempted by all those things that we see and say, well, this might work, and God wants me to do this, and this would really help me do that thing, so I'm just going to do it. And Corinthians speaks to us about that. Everything is permitted, but everything isn't beneficial. As I often said to Micah as he's growing up, everything is good, but not everything is helpful. Everything is permitted, but everything doesn't build others up. Yes? There is going to be nothing in God's plan that will be at the expense of your neighbor. Let me just say that again. There's going to be nothing in God's plan for you that will be at the expense of your neighbor. So if I'm going to be purposeful, then I need to be concerned and be attentive that things I'm doing don't tear people down. But that my walk with God helps build others up. Good? No one should look out for their own advantage, but they should look out for each other. What's God's purpose for us? To look out for each other. So whether you eat or drink, down to little bits of things, the little details that so many of us are concerned about, So whether you eat or drink, or whatever you do, you should do it all for God's glory. So if we think the littlest decisions don't matter, think again. Everything matters. Are you purposeful? Yes? Do you make decisions about the things you're doing on purpose? I probably drive Shelley crazy because I always have a reason for everything I'm doing. You know, it's like, well, why do we have to do it that way? Let me tell you. I actually have a reason. And so sometimes when I'm with somebody else, if you don't have a reason, then it's harder to adjust. That's part of being intentional or purposeful. Even wanting to dance out today, I wanted to feature the babies. And I always see Andy dancing at the back. It's kind of funny that she wouldn't dance at the front today. But every week in praise time, Andy is running back and forth back there and dancing up a storm, and you never get to enjoy that sheer delight of a child at God's music and being in the house of God. Part of being in the house of God for her is to dance. And for us to be with that, you know, and dance out a little energy in some of these other kids before we send them off to the Sunday school teachers is not a bad thing. Right? There's actually reasons for it. But whatever it is that we're doing, to do it for God's glory, to do it for a reason that gives God glory and honor, and to honor the little children in our midst, suffer the children to come unto me, God, Jesus said, to lift up the children and make a place for them in God's house, and to make it be a place where the kids want to be instead of, I have to. Have them have a sense of feeling that this is a house of love. We do it all for God's glory. So even though there's things that are good but maybe not helpful, we have to be paying attention. And from that earliest text we said, pay attention to my instructions, the word said, right? Learn them and put them on your heart. So it was summarized by the prophet Micah for us as well to remember. And what does God require of you? I don't think I gave them this for the PowerPoint. What does God require of you? Do you know the answer? To act justly comes the first thing. To love mercy, we know it in different translations. To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. What's God's plan for you? What does God want you to do? Act with justice. To show mercy, compassion, care. And to walk humbly with God. If I'm walking humbly with God, I am journeying daily with God. I am walking side by side with Spirit at all times, right? These are the commandments that God wants us to take off the page and digest and have them in our heart. These are the instructions, the rules, the guidelines. Now, some of us, when we think about God's plan for us or God's purpose, we go to the Great Commission. Go teach, baptize. But some people are very busy about doing, and we've missed that being that I was talking about earlier, and the being resides in the Great Commandment. I've got to get the Great Commandment before I can get the Great Commission. Does that make sense? Otherwise, I may be doing it for my own victory, for my own success, for my own stats, and not doing it all for God's glory. So I have to go back to that Great Commandment. Love the Lord your God. How? With all your heart, with all your being, with all your mind. Different translations, strength, but it's your whole self, your whole self. And I'm going to say once again, many of us love God like we use computers, about 10%. And this is about our whole self. That was the passionate part I was talking about last week too. So to be more purposeful is to really open up to journeying with God in everything, to make every decision with God's direction, in consultation, to make sure that what I'm doing and how I'm being lifts up other people. Because really when it comes down to it, our purpose is really simple in life. Love God, love others. You've heard me say it. Do we have it yet? Love God, love others. The rest is the details. Amen? So again, it's not what we do, but how we do it. And we can't get to the what without the relationship. So my purpose, your purpose, is to live in relationship with God, right? To live in relationship, a just relationship with others. That's our purpose. It's first to love God, love others, love self, and second, it's to follow where God leads. Because I want to. If I'm going to stay in relationship with God and God's moving, I'm moving with God, like we were singing earlier. Yes? If God's moving in this direction and I want to stay in that relationship with God, I'm going to move with God. And where you go, I'll go. Where you lead, I'll lead. Where you move, I'll move. Where you follow, lead, I will follow. To live purposefully is to live with intent, with direction. And to do that, you lead and I'll follow. God is the one taking us. We can't follow if we're not connecting. We can't follow if we're not trusting. We can't get directions from God if we're not listening. If we're unclear about our purpose, if we feel that we're less than purposeful in our lives, get connected more. That's where it begins. Purposefully seeking God's leading. And don't worry if you have all the details. Trust. Trust that God will reveal the details as you can handle them and as you need them. Because I think some of us are still waiting for those details so we can say, I'm not sure if I agree. There's nothing in Scripture that says we get to agree or negotiate it, right? I'm either all in or I'm not. This is an all-in experience. Seeking God's presence, being in communion with Spirit, connected, purposefully following the example of Jesus. That example of Jesus was loving God and loving others. So I want us to practice getting up in the morning and saying, today I will do my best to be loving to myself. Today, I will do my best to be loving to others I encounter. Today, I will do my best to be filled with divine love. Today, I will be in loving relationship with God. I want you to just look at that for a moment. Think about how that could shape your day and living more purposefully. My intention is to be loving to myself. For some, that's the hardest piece of work. Today I'll do my best to be loving to others I encounter. For others in the church, that's the hardest piece of work. The last two both deal with loving God, but they're a little bit different. I do my best to be filled with divine love means I'm opening myself to let Spirit come in. I will be in loving relationship with God is interactive. Okay, two aspects of loving God. Would you say this prayer with me again? Today, I will do my best to be loving to myself. Today, I will do my best to be loving to others I encounter. Today, I will do my best to be filled with divine love. Today, I will be in loving relationship with God. I want to encourage you to pray some version of that every morning this week and see if it helps you be more purposeful about being present to God and present to others. More a sense of living into your divine calling to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with God, to live into that divine calling, to live as passionate and purposeful people. So we're going to sing the song, You Lead and I'll Follow. It's a song, I have my sermon notes and I have my other, we're singing the song that the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir did, Lead Me, Lord, I Will Follow. And it's that prayer that connects us to really follow where God would take us and trust. So if the plan goes a little bit like this, if it was drawn out, I'm still trusting that God's getting me there. I'm going to go where God goes. Instead of trying to figure out what specifically does God have for me, go with God. And start with the little basics. Love God. Love others. Amen.
It's hard to take the first step. Probably all of us have a time when something in us said, that's it, that's the moment. This is the time I understand who God is in my life. And the moment we felt accepted and felt that we knew and didn't need to keep questioning. We knew we were with God and we knew we were okay. I came to MCC in the 70s. And like many of you, was on that journey because at that time there wasn't a place. But I have to tell you, there was a moment in the very first service that I attended at MCC that was that moment that said, it's okay, God is with you, and you'll find what God wants you to be. You'll find the person God wants you to be. And that moment was at this table. Of all that had been said, sung, and done in that service, it was when we gathered at the table. It was the first time I'd had communion in 20 years or more. But it was that moment. And I hope that every Sunday, that when you come to this table, no matter how many times you've done that, or how many years, or how few that you have done, that it can always be a moment for you. Because Jesus said, do this and remember, call me back to your mind and heart and know I'm there. And that's really what communion is about. And it helps us to once again open up our minds and hearts to the God who loves us and includes us and helps us find our purpose in life. We're all on that journey, as we always have been. Jesus was on the journey of his life. And then the night before he suffered, took bread, gave thanks and blessed and broke it, and gave it to them, to us, and said, eat of this, all of you, this is my body opened for you. So, and when you do this, know you receive me. Know that I'm with you. And in the same way, at that same meal, took the cup and said, drink from it, all of you, because this is the cup of the future. This is the cup of grace and things to come. Drink from this, all of you, because this is another way that you receive me and know that I'm there. And these words have remained true. God's gifts remain in us and with us and practiced through us in all of our lives. Thank you, God, always, for such love and grace. Thank you that for your forgiveness, your care and concern. Thank you for love that never fails. Bring us back to this day, to the moments in our lives that we trust you, know you're real, and are able to act on your grace in us. Amen.
Thank you for taking the time today to listen to this message. I hope that you heard something that touched you. We want to engage with you, not just send out these sermon videos and let them just be out there somewhere. But we want to engage with you, so I want to invite you to write your comments in the YouTube comment section below the sermon, or come find us on Facebook and share with me your questions, your comments, your insights. Find us at our website, mccgd.org. There's a number of different ways in which you can engage with us from wherever you are, another state, another country, homebound, whatever your situation. Most of all, I want you to know that you are a part of the extended community of this church. You are a part of the family of God. You are a beloved child of God. Thank you for watching.